Today's episode of Filmmaker U is brought to you by our sponsors, OWC. Go to owcdigital.com for all your filmmaking and computer needs. And it's also brought to you by our other sponsors, AJA. Make sure to check out AJA.com so that you can see how they can help you in your post-production needs.
Hi, I'm Gordon Burkell from Filmmaker U. At Filmmaker U, we create courses for film professionals to deepen and diversify your existing skill set. You can learn more at FilmmakerU.com or, of course, follow us on Twitter at Filmmaker_U. Every week, we interview film professionals to discuss their work. And this week, I'm joined by production designer Laurin Kelsey, whose work includes Night at the Museum 2, The Fall of the House of Usher, and more recently, The Midnight Club. Welcome to the show, Laurin.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
I want to ask you, you spent some time in Germany. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, what did you pick up there from a creative stance? Because I remember Berlin, everyone I've talked to who's been there is just like, it's a creative hub, essentially. So what are some interesting ideas or things you saw happening over there that you've used nowadays in your work?
Yeah, but, I mean, that's a great question. I loved living in Berlin. I was there for about 4 years. And creatively, what's really interesting about Berlin is it has so many layers to it. So you have, obviously, the war-torn layers that's still visible, so you can see bullet holes. Then you have the Soviet Union layer of the 60s, where there's this very rigid architecture, especially obviously in East Berlin, mm-hmm. what was formerly East Berlin. And then you have a really cool, modern, sleek movement, and they literally build on top of the same buildings. So the bottom half will be this war-torn, old columns building, and then on top they'll build this beautiful glass, you know, spiral staircase. So I think one of the most interesting things that I took away from being somewhere with so much history is really thinking in depth about the layers of a place or a thing or a home, for example, and how you see every visible layer as it evolves through time.
It's interesting because I think about whenever I talk to production designers, one of the things they always say is like, if like you're doing something in 1985, you might be using stuff from the 70s, the 50s, everything to make it look real, mm-hmm. right? And it sounds like Germany is like production designed for real life.
Yeah, in a way it is, isn't it?
Did you, when you were there, I'm assuming you traveled throughout Germany. So did you check out things like, you know, like where the Weimar Republic was or the Bauhaus stuff and really research that stuff or?
I mean, I did. I was lucky enough. Germany does a language integration course. So after a bit of time, I enrolled and learned how to improve my German, actually, and sort of take it to another level. And part of that is learning a layer of German culture. So once you've gotten through your language part, you take a cultural class. And we traveled, we had a couple field trips that took us into like Leipzig and other areas where those movements were really prominent. So it was very, very interesting to see all that. And I think a lot of that design history in Germany is still very present. So one of my favorite things to do, and I ran a very small vintage resale shop while I was there on the side, but my favorite thing was to go to the flea markets because so much of that European design, there's such an influx of it there that it's very like accessible. So you can get all kinds of very cool old vases and different types of, I guess, artifacts, if you will, from all those time periods and all those such like massive influential design periods that you don't really see, or it's harder to find over here in North America.
I'm going to interrupt this interview for 1 second. We want to thank Pixelview, one of our sponsors. They're a streaming solution for filmmakers. Pixelview lets you stream your work to remote clients for easy collaboration, and it works with both on-set teams and post-production teams. With built-in video chat, you can discuss and make changes in real time and stream directly from your editing software. Or you can use the hardware encoder to stream from DaVinci Resolve or the camera on set. See the promo code and the link in the video description below. Yeah, that's my frustration when I go to Europe. I'm like, oh, it's so cool. So like, it's so beautiful. Like the architecture, the way they've kept everything. And then we come here and you're like, they knocked down our buildings, put up, you know, a condo that's like the one next to it. It's so sad to see.
But it's nice. It creates like a lot of opportunities when you go over there to be, like lit up. You see different mm-hmm. And it's hard not to be excited when you're over there.
Now, how did you get involved with the Midnight Club?
I was super fortunate for Midnight Club. I worked on a previous show called Midnight Mass that Mike Flanagan created and directed. And I wanted to work on Midnight Mass because he hired a phenomenal designer, Steve Arnold, of Mindhunter and a ton of very House of Cards, tons of shows. And I was hired as an art director. And through the process of Midnight Mass, I got a lot of time to get to know Mike and Intrepid Pictures, which is the production company that him and Trevor Macy have, and develop a relationship. And so when it came time to do Midnight Club and Steve was otherwise engaged, they came to me and asked if I would do the show. And I was blown away, and it was very unexpected, and I felt incredibly lucky.
I feel like it was an incredibly challenging show, just given the amount of production design that has to go into it. So how did you tackle everything? Because I'm assuming they weren't like, oh, we'll give you a couple extra weeks. They're probably like, oh, yeah, we still have the same deadline that we usually have. So how did you tackle this to stay on top of things?
Well, it is a really challenging one. What I loved about it, though, is that you have so many different time periods and so many different layers. And then you have not only what we call the A story, which is obviously about Brightcliff and the kids, but all these little B stories. And I tried to break it down really quickly into chunks. I chunked it. So I made the A story sort of one world. And then I tried to create, through color and through the concept that I used in Brightcliff, a way to contain all of the other stories. So for example, I used color a lot. I gave each of the teens their own color and sort of their own color story. So when they were in Brightcliff, they were their rooms or their personal belongings sort of stuck to a very limited palette and theme. And then when I carried over into their B stories, I used the same color palette so that they kind of had their world. And that really helped to not let the B stories, which were obviously all set in the 90s, which is a much more colorful period than say a Victorian home had, and much more vivid. I tried to allow it to amp up, but to stay in the same family, to kind of keep everything within a bubble so that with all the layers of time periods and, you know, visions that Alanka has, and then the B stories, you don't feel cluttered, like visually cluttered, because there's just so much going on.
So one of the questions I like when I talk to cinematographers, shows and everything are getting darker. Mm-hmm. And what I'm interested in knowing when I talk to cinematographers, I'm always like, how do you shoot darkness mm-hmm. so that people can still see it? So mm-hmm. as a production designer, what was your working on? Like, I think about when they're around the fireplace telling mm-hmm. the stories, it's a dark scene, but we can still make things out. Like how much are you building into that? Like, are you allowing things, like, are you keeping things dark so that it looks dark? Or are you letting the cinematographer do that work? Where's that break up for you?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's both. It's working really closely with the cinematographer, and we had James Neist setting up our pilot and doing the first block, and then later we had other cinematographers as well. But Jimmy and I worked really closely, testing a lot of samples and looking at what he was going to do with light. You can see through the different episodes that different directors and different DPs used different levels of lighting in the library. So it was sort of like setting an overall theory for it and then creating the opportunities through the colors that I chose to go whatever direction they wanted to go. And then with the use of set deck, bringing in practicals and light fixtures, you can have as many of the sconces on as you want. You can have just the fire illuminating and leaving that choices to them as to how much they want to be able to make out of the rest of the room. And then one of the things with Brightcliff also is because it needs to feel kind of hopeful in the daytime and then very eerie at night, was going through a really sort of subdued palette, which was appropriate for the period of House as well. Because that, when you give it a little bit more warmth and light, kind of felt more uplifted. But when they wanted to turn things down, the cooler tones and the wood tones and everything, I think it gets eerie really fast. So I think that was kind of my way of supporting what they wanted to be able to do.
So what would you say was like your favorite era or B story to work in?
Oh, that's such a hard one. My favorite era, was probably, oh, that's so hard. Because with Brightcliff, what I loved was that you saw it in four different eras. So each era had something really interesting to give. The 1900s, obviously, you're looking at what would the original fixtures be? How ornate did they decorate it? You know, they tended to use a lot more fresh flowers and things like that, which was so fun to dig into. But then also you get something like the 60s, which has such a specific tone to it and a specific palette as well that we're all very familiar with. And the set deck in the 60s is obviously always one of my favorites. It's so fun. And so in the A story itself, I loved all the time periods really. And then in the B stories, I think because they're all set in the 90s, there wasn't as much variation in time periods there to get into. But my favorite B story to do was Eternal Enemy. That's Spencer's story with the robotics, because we got to build this really funky lab, which you only see in kind of like little flashes, but we built this big room with all this glass and all these like industrial kind of creepy machines, because it was really fun to look at what a futuristic room looks like, but from the perspective of 1994. So you're getting into more, you know, Terminator-esque futures, which is kind of fun and a little bit more jagged and meaty than what we do now for future, where everything's round and smooth and white.
Now, is there like a particular like artistic movement or design movement that you particularly like or you would use in your house?
Well, that's a really interesting question. I think like as a designer, we always have sort of our aesthetic tendencies. So for example, at home, I love, which is still quite a popular movement right now, is mid-century modern, 50s, 60s. And I like an eclectic mix. So I do have from the vintage shop that I ran when I was in Berlin, I have old cameras in my place and vases that are from like the Weimar Republic movement and things like that. Because I find that time period to have very clean lines, and it was sort of, you know, everything's less automated. Everything still feels very real and tangible and has texture and is adventurous. But I think, yeah, as a designer, when you're designing, you have to be so careful not to put your lens on things, but to not limit and, prevent what the story needs, by what your tendencies are. So really like finding, your stamp to put on it without overstamping it, if that makes sense.
Well, it's interesting because it makes me think of like whenever I see at the new like home automation stuff or the new, everyone's sort of trying to mimic Apple and be clean and slick and but it's kind of weird because it almost feels like it has no, like you said, texture or a personality, I guess would be another way of saying it. Yeah. It doesn't sound like fun to have all these clean stuff. Now you also work in theater. So, you know, like what would you say is the difference between production design for a film and working in the theater?
Oh, can you hear that? Is that bothering you? No, okay. Sorry. So the difference between designing for theater and designing for film, I think is the level of, actually, can I start over on that one? The difference for designing between theater and film is kind of like twofold. One is that in theater, I feel like you're so much more hands-on. And that's something that I hear a lot when I'm working in film, is that I'm quite hands-on. because that comes from a world of having a smaller team and having to be much more integrated in the process, building your own props or getting right down there with the crews and you know, being more involved than in film, where we have a little bit more separation and there's a lot more individual specialized positions to take care of everything. And then the other big difference, which I love, and again, I think it supports film, is because theater is a live performance, and often you're changing sets and you have to get very creative with how to change things quickly and how to be very, you know, robust and versatile in your design. I think that it makes for a really interesting background when you're into film. So for example, for Brightcliff, We have the long hallway where all the dorm rooms are, and we have something like, I think we go into seven different dorm rooms. And Mike's really a big proponent of being able to do a lot of things as practically as possible. So he wanted to be able to do continuous shots down the hallway and then turn to the door and be in someone's room. But of course, on a stage, we just don't necessarily have enough space to do that. So my little theater background brain decided to build the bedrooms on wheels. So we built two bedrooms on wheels, and then we would just move them from doorway to doorway and change the wallpaper and obviously change the set deck. But it meant that we could have two built bedrooms, which was obviously great for budget, but we could still provide him with six or seven rooms that practically played off of the right doorways in the hallway.
Wow, that's really interesting. So you've also done props though in this stuff. So it sounds like, does the props department like show up and they're like, hey, why are you building our props?
Well, I try not to build props too much anymore. that was the first opportunity I got in film. So I was really lucky. I grew up on Salt Spring Island in BC and came from a very creative community. And we had a work experience. And for some totally bizarre reason, I got sent to Vancouver to work on Stargate, the TV series, in the props department. And I was invited to art department meetings and just got like, I was so well treated. I was only 16 at the time. So it was like, it was pretty cool to be able to have access to all of that. And it just sparked this huge love, not only for art department and ultimately for production design, but for props. And the prop master at the time entrusted me with building a lot of, I did like all the personal journals for the scientists and a lot of drawings and like practical handheld props. And it just was something I loved so much that nowadays it's like, I really recognize the importance of props. I think sometimes, and I've been a prop master in the past, sometimes it can be a department that gets a little bit less attention, you know, than construction and doing the actual big set builds. But those are the things that are right up against the camera and they have so much story to them. I really love being involved with props, but I don't really build them anymore.
Now, is there a genre of film or television that you would love to do, but you just haven't had a chance to do it yet?
I mean, I haven't really done sci-fi since my prop days, and I haven't really done it as an art director or a production designer. So I think that that would be very interesting, but really my main interest, and I've been lucky enough with the last two shows with Mike to be able to do, is really period drama. So even though he's in the horror genre, I think there's such a dramatic element to his work. It's not your traditional horror, I think. And then working in different time periods. So being able to do something like The Midnight Club, and then next year you'll get to see The Fall of the House of Usher. Those really are exactly what I want to do. So I've been quite fortunate. I was very excited when I got the scripts and saw that we were going to get to delve into different time periods and create such amazing architecture.
I have one last question that I like to ask everyone I interview. What would you say is your favorite guilty pleasure film or TV show to watch?
It's actually completely embarrassing. I don't know why this is, but when I was growing up, I got really into reading a lot of mysteries with my dad. So I was really into things like James Bond and Indiana Jones. And that led me to be super into something like Jack Ryan. So my guilty pleasure is to put on 90s Jack Ryan films with Harrison Ford in the background.
not Alec Baldwin, not Hunt for the Red October.
No, sadly not the Ben Affleck, Sum of All Fears. No, we've got to go back back to the 90s. And maybe John Krasinski's new series, maybe.
Yeah. Oh, thank you so much for letting me interview today.
Absolutely. Thank you for your time. It was great.
And that's it for this week. Make sure to check us out at filmmakeru.com and of course on Twitter at @filmmaker_u. I'm Gord Burkell. Thanks for watching.
Today's episode of Filmmaker U is brought to you by our sponsors, OWC. Go to owcdigital.com for all your filmmaking and computer needs. And it's also brought to you by our other sponsors, AJA. Make sure to check out aja.com so that you can see how they can help you in your post-production needs.